Okay? It's no.
You're going to be able to protect yourself. We give it up right now. We'll be dead within 2 weeks.
We don't belong to any gang, we belong to a gang.
I don't see it, man. If you're running about a gang, you get chipped. That's your hard line, isn't it? You shouldn't have grass, you shouldn't have tell the screws.
Members of the Shamrock Gang gather in the centre of Glasgow. Despite Frankie Vaughan's efforts on one estate, the Glasgow gangs still exist. In a city of over 1 million good people, there is still a minority prepared to resort to explosive violence for kicks. How did Joe Devlin, not yet 17, become leader of the Shamrock?
I did my time inside. Everybody just, you know, take me for a little man, you know, because I do things people don't do, you know. Like you say, I'm always at the front of the crowd if there's a fight, you know? I'm always right in the front if there's any damage. There's nearly everybody wants to get the front, you know, but I always see me end up in the front, you know, when there's a fight.
You fight with your fists?
No, we'll use hatchets and that. You know, other kind of weapons, anything at all, you know?
You might kill somebody.
Oh, well, you don't think you're going to kill them. I mean, like you say, if sexies plunge him at the same time, it's a good chance, you know, but you don't think you're going to kill him too, maybe after that. He may be seriously ill or something like that, you know, but you don't think you're going to do him in, but it's happened a couple of times. Like I said, the boys killed that bloke in the fleet, did him in. Some of the boys did a bit of grass and 4 of them stayed in time. We don't like that at all. That's how we were doing that time to see the score, you know.
How did you feel when you heard that heard that somebody had actually died there, in a fight?
I get a good night's sleep after that. I don't bother.
You'd not have been too worried if you had done him in, would you?
I would have been worried, you know, but you don't think you're going to do him in, you know? I mean, like I say, the bloke's lying there screaming. As long as he still screams, it's okay, you know? He doesn't scream. It's just phone for the ambulance right away.
Saturday night in Glasgow is busy night for the hospitals. Victims of casual violence queue for treatment alongside the 20th century's more orthodox casualties. In 1967, there were 1,465 reported crimes of violence in Glasgow. But the real figure is likely to be greater. The doctors have to take their patients' word for the cause of their wounds. It is often wiser not to talk. This boy said he fell on a bottle. Perhaps he did. Drink is often the fuel of violence, and alcoholism is 5 times more common in Scotland than England. It is not the only cause. The gangs will fight cold sober while the drunks sit it out. Saturday night in the Locarno dance hall, and Glasgow belongs to its youth. Burly men watch warily for the known troublemakers. Glasgow sprawls over 62 square miles, but the entertainment spots are crammed into a few streets in the city centre. On Saturday, all roads lead to Sockey Hall Street. For most, the Locarno is a place for an evening's innocent enjoyment. For a few, it is a disputed no-man's land. Everything is planned to nip trouble in the bud. The front door is heavily guarded, and each male must submit to a frisking. Some are known to the doorman and are asked firmly to go elsewhere. But the weapons are not easy to find. Only the boys are frisked, and a sharpened steel comb slips easily into a handbag. The more experienced gang members take good care not to be caught in possession of an offensive weapon. Mr. James Cameron, Mecca's Scottish director, is satisfied his men do a good job.
Well, we have been doing this searching since the war, in actual fact. We're looking for alcohol in Glasgow. It's a very well-known thing that you have a carry-out. And they have lots of these teenagers have half bottles of something. If it's not vodka, it's whiskey or something like that, and we're looking for it. And we take it off them, give them a ticket for it, and they, to retrieve it on the way out. That's exactly why. At the same time, no doubt you've heard about the violence in Glasgow, and it serves as a double purpose nowadays. Should they have any weapons with them, we are able to find same. But we're happy to say it's very seldom we do find any weapons.
How many staff, how many sort of straight bouncers do you have in there?
Well, they're known as supervisors, ballroom supervisors. This word bouncer is it's outdated as far as we're concerned, but we have 12. And a very heavy front door staff, as you see, because we look upon it that the front door is to prevent them coming in altogether. But should anything unforeseen happen inside, we will stop it as soon as possible, as quickly as possible.
Some troublemakers succeed in slipping past Mr. Cameron's guard. Then the system moves into action to remove them as quickly and as speedily as possible. But there is no way of planning for the peculiar, unpredictable nature of teenage violence. To combat gang violence, the chief constable has formed a special squad of men known to the gangs as the Untouchables. The police, who say they are on top of the problem, never officially use the word gang fight.
Sergeant McMaster, you're one of what I understand in Glasgow referred to as an untouchable. What's the word mean?
The Untouchable series was devised from a television series which was particularly popular in Glasgow. The plainclothes officers in America were used to combat federal offences, and the local youth have used this as a nickname for the group disorder vehicles which operate in the city.
You say group disorder, a gang fight?
Group disorder is a better word, I would say.
Sergeant, what exactly do you do?
Well, prior to 1966, there were numerous outbreaks of group disorders in the housing schemes of the city, and in January 1967, the chief constable formed in each division a group disorder vehicle composed of a sergeant and a number of constables. The object of this was to combat group disorder. Obviously, one constable or two constables on duty in the street coming across perhaps a number of youths engaged in group disorder were unable to combat this on their own, and these vehicles were brought in to being so that in the event of a call being received, they could be quickly dispatched to the scene and deal with the situation as they found it.
I've spoken, though, to young people here who say, or it's not gang warfare, but that they still sort of can't go off this scheme down into another scheme or down into other areas without the risk of running into trouble. Is this so?
I wouldn't say so. I think that's a ridiculous assumption on their part. Any person can walk freely in any street in Glasgow without danger of being molested in any way.
Oh, Sergeant, people have been stabbed in the streets of Glasgow.
People have been stabbed in the streets elsewhere too.
A black eye gained in a fair fight is flaunted like a battle honour. There is little doubt that the gangs exaggerate their own importance. But surely behind their somewhat grandiose claims to have divided the centre of Glasgow among themselves, there is a lonely need to belong. They lay claim to territory and fight to hold it.
Shamrock's got a good bit of territory down the town, you know, Dundas Street, Gale Street. You know, they've got a good bit. And I like to say, if any other team come in here, you know, I like to say, we walk about these places, and if any other team comes in here, it's a fight right away. That's the way it goes.
What do you mean you've got this territory? I mean, this is an open street in the middle of a city.
Well, like I say, it can be, you know, Union Street in Glasgow. Come be run a bit there. That's their territory, you know. We can't go along here, although not unless maybe there's one or two's, you know, because it's busy. They can't come along here. If they do come along, there's bound to be a team of them. That's a fight.
Do you keep the fights private among yourselves? I mean, I can walk down these streets.
No, don't think so. I mean, I mean, if you're standing there on a gang fee, you'll probably just get what anybody else is getting.
Ah, but if I just walk down it, I mean, you don't... I'm allowed to come down the street if I'm not... if I'm not with you or with one of the other gangs.
Well, like, say, the Shamrock, that's one thing about them, you know, they don't take liberties, you know, but Cumbie, you know, they take, like, say, if they run down a street, fighting that, they just hit anybody.
Yummy, 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 we're the Sissay Cumbie and we feel like chubbing a tin.
The identification with the gang is sometimes total. The Cumbie gang claim the rapidly vanishing slumland of the Gorbals as their territory, but few live there. When I asked where they lived, they replied not with place names, but with the names of their nearest gang.
I live out beside the Shamrock.
I live beside the Fleet.
I live beside the Bundy.
I live beside the
Hull.
So most of you live north of the river?
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, how you run with a gang on the south side?
Because of the best team in here.
Because everybody used to come for here for the suicide. That's how you just keep them back down to suicide.
And we're the best team in Glasgow.
Yay! It's like a regiment.
Oh,
it's not us. It is. It's like a clan.
Not black watch,
it's like
anyway.
A clan. I mean, you stand by them.
It's just mates. Just mates you've got. You get more mates. You'd just be running about with one or two mates, you know.
Well, look at the birds we've got. They're brilliant. Oh, that's a dollar, yummy.
Two slaps.
Most people who come from the south look at the Gorbals and they say, hell with that place. I mean, that's really the worst place I've ever seen, and yet it means a lot to you.
Because,
why?
Because we originated from here, and we're going to stay here, no matter what comes up or what comes down.
You grow up here, don't you?
But what's it got that the new places haven't got?
Atmosphere. I mean, people are friendly down here now. I mean, the atmosphere at these schemes.
Faced with a housing problem of disaster proportions, the Glasgow Corporation have built over 80,000 homes since the war. It is a remarkable achievement. But they have been criticised for not providing sufficient shops and community facilities on the estates. The young say the estates are just a place to sleep, and in Black Hill, the few shops are steel shuttered against the violence which some say is born of boredom. Thanks to the efforts of Frankie Vaughan, the Easter House estate now looks as if it is going to get a youth centre. It remains to be seen if that will end the violence. But for the mothers on the estate, talking with their MP Hugh Brown, there is no doubt that Easter House lacks a community heart.
There's no community centre here, amongst the people themselves. There's no spirit. We all come up here with good intentions. We came here thinking we're giving our children a better chance. We're moving out of the city itself, coming out to fresh air, open fields and all the rest of it, which was all we do have. And what has happened? Nothing's happened.
Well,
I mean, the shopping centre,
we've
promised libraries. We've now got a library open 2 weeks ago, and we've been 10 years here.
Uh-huh.
I mean, what else is there?
I've heard this from the kids, I've heard it from the mothers here. Now, why didn't you build these things in the first place?
Well, the library is a specific example of where we've been caught up, because there is a new library planned to be part of the major commercial centre.
Why didn't you do all these things to begin with?
Well, it is, yes. One of the reasons you didn't do it then was because the commercial interests weren't interested in coming in until the scheme had been fully completed. You can't force private enterprise to come in until they're ready to. We're talking in terms of £3 or £4 million of investment in here, and you won't get them to come in until.
Why not? Just a hut, that's all we need.
I'm sorry, if I can interrupt you, Mr. Brown. I mean, when towns are built to other places in the country, when they build the new towns, I mean, they build a community centre, they build swimming pools, they build libraries. At that time, why didn't you do it 10 years ago?
Well, no, I don't think this is true. I don't think this always happens in every new town. But it's quite true. The main reason for it was the demand for housing. Don't forget, we're talking in the post-war demands of people like this lady here. Quite rightly so. This was their first corporation house. Desperate to get a new house because they were overcrowded. So the emphasis was in housing. Build more housing and the community facilities will come along after. There's a two-way here thing here. I'm not excusing the
mistakes and the failures and the delays and what we've been talking about. But as I say, there's also, if you like, in a democratic community, there's more need for us to talk oftener and try and understand why some of these difficulties have arisen, and also to encourage people to take more part in the running of their own affairs in local organisations. There should be more active adults in churches or in all sorts of voluntary bodies who should be coming along and saying, look, what can I do to help to make this better?
If they put one community centre in each section, I think it would help an awful lot.
Yeah.
I think it really would help. The one at Well House, if our boys go down to Well House, there's a gang down there, he's already been down there. Our boys go down there, they get chased back up again. They're not allowed in. See? And I think if you really built a community centre in each section, as Mr. Brown already knows that, if it was built in each section, I think it would help an awful lot. Because I have a boy at 15 too, and he would go to these centres, but he'll not go down to Well House.
Why won't he go down?
Because he's afraid to go down. I have a boy at 18 and he won't go near Well House.
He wouldn't be allowed in,
he wouldn't be allowed in, he'd get chased.
No. It's on a territorial basis and there just aren't enough of them.
Showbiz personality or social worker? Somehow Frankie Vaughan manages to combine the two. No one can accuse him of doing good by stealth. Yet those who thought that he would quickly drop his interest in Glasgow have been confounded. He has been back and back again.
Cheese.
Somehow, Vaughan does appear to have established a bridgehead between the adult world of law and order and the youth. Yet his first venture could hardly have given him much cause for optimism. No one knew quite what to expect when the police agreed to Vaughan's proposal for an amnesty, during which gang weapons could be handed in. But most of Easter House, reinforced by a small army of pressmen and photographers, came along to watch the fun. At first it looked as if nothing at all was going to happen. Then the weapons, that is what they were, began to arrive. It looked as if someone had been raiding the backyard of a hardware store. Even by the standards of the gangs, much of what was handed in appeared to come within the category of obsolescent. In the midst of it all, the police maintained a passive neutrality. As a social experiment, the proceedings had an odd carnival air, and although he has since become a trustee of the Youth Centre project, Glasgow's police convener, Bailey Anderson, was unimpressed.
Well, of course, this is a comic opera, nothing more, nothing less.
Why do you say that?
Well, I say this quite simply because, speaking to some of the gang leaders this afternoon, they're just going along for the publicity, they're just taking people for a ride.
You believe that this is, if it's not done any good, do you believe it may have done harm?
Yes, I think it's done a great deal of harm because I think, quite frankly, that this has idolised the people who commit those crimes of violence, and those children see the gang leaders being idolised, being publicised. And of course, I think those children will attempt to emulate those gang leaders who have attracted so much attention.
Mr. Anderson, if this isn't the answer, what is the answer to Glasgow's gang problem?
Well, we have found the problem by deterrent sentences in the High Court. Well, they have been ranging in the past week between 8 and 12 years imprisonment for attacks by an offensive weapon. And I think this is the real and the true answer. We must just simply, it's at the stage when we have to frighten people into good behaviour.
But aren't there, in fact, also, deep social reasons for this?
No, well, I don't see the deep social reasons for this, because we have got hundreds of and thousands of good kids here in Easter House who live in the same housing conditions, who have the same educational opportunities, who have the same job prospects. They behave themselves. They are good citizens. So, you see, I cannot accept that.
I mean, don't you accept what many sociologists and people like that say are the underlying causes of the gangs, the lack of a community spirit, the lack of a community life in the estates and things like that?
I don't accept this at all, not for one minute, because not all the gangs are centred in Easter House or in the vast housing estates. So let the sociologists explain why gangs should not be in other areas of the city where there is a similar problem.
It seems to me what you're saying, Bailey Anderson, is that the authority has no more answer to the gangs than simply to meet their violence with heavy sentences.
Yes, I think this is the real answer, because I quite simply believe that the greatest deterrent against a person committing a crime is the sure and certain knowledge that they will be caught, convicted and adequately punished. I know this is frightening people into good behaviour, but I am afraid that this is the only answer, and as police convener, this is the action that I'm taking, and which is meeting with quite a degree of success.
You're going to end up in Barlinnie if you go on like this, aren't you, Joe?
It's a good chance, yeah. Probably will come, you know. But, well, I mean, if it comes, it comes, you know. You don't fancy it, but you can't be helped, can you? You don't think you're getting to jail, but if you get jail, that's it.
What does the gang mean to you, Joe? How important is it in your life?
It doesn't mean to us. It doesn't bother. You know, just that. There's nothing else to do, so... I mean, started running a bit for, you know, for a laugh, you know? Started running a bit with them. Then people get to know you. You get to know people now. And that's it. You just got to keep going. Keep on going with them. Because you kind of chuck it.
Yeah, when it's all said and done, Joe, you'd really like to get out of it, wouldn't you?
I'd like to go, but it's too late now. Maybe if I mean, I'm good, I'll try, you know, stay away, but tried a couple of times. It's hard, you know.
We offer the same kind of opportunities to these youngsters that we would offer to middle-class children. I think this is there's a very strong social class problem here. We have to give them good schooling, and I mean really good education. We have to give them social opportunities to be able to talk in a civilised way, to be able to behave in a civilised way. We have to offer them entertainment opportunities with constructive use of themselves in a variety of ways. We can't start this, I don't think, with the 17-year-old very easily. We're always doing a repair job on the 17-year-old. We've got to start with the 3-year-old in terms of preschool playgroups. We've got to have smaller classes in school. We've got to have play facilities outside the school. We've got to involve the mothers and fathers of the families, not in a negative, but in a positive way. Now, what I mean by that is that at the moment, we tend to attack the parents for not being good parents. I think what they need is help in understanding the kind of activities the youngsters are engaging in. We've got to increase the opportunities for these young people to get jobs like apprentices, and not just dull labouring jobs that aren't worthwhile doing.
By the time the social reforms that you talk about and the expenditure of money that is needed is taking place, a lot of these people are just going to be in jail, the 16, 17-year-olds, aren't they?
Yes, this is very sad. And perhaps we've got to make a decision to let this generation go. One of the things that worries me is that people are always moaning about these problems, but they're never prepared to take a cold look at what it's going to cost to mend them. And I would suggest that if we started really preventative levels of work, that we would find that this was helping a lot of problems other than the particular one they're worried about, gang violence.
We want Frankie Vaughan!
The children greet Frankie Vaughan as they would any pop singer. But the response of the teenagers has been more interesting and is of much greater importance.
The reason I came here today is that I wanted to meet as many of the lads and girls as possible, right? There's no point in me going here with any plans unless you're all in on it and you've seen the
proposed... For the moment, he appears to have got through to them. In return for his promise to help raise money for a youth centre on the estate, the Easter House boys have agreed to give up their allegiance to the gangs. They've even scrubbed the slogans from the walls.
Things that you want to be involved with in the centre. For sport, there's badminton, tournament tennis, boxing ring, trampoline, 9 table tennis. Table tennis.
No one knows how long the truce will last. And even if the experiment is a success, it will not mean that the problem of Glasgow's violent teenagers has been solved overnight. But a new start has been made.
And of course, you've got coffee areas and a place to dance, sort of discotheques.
But not all Glasgow's youth live in Easter House. For the Spur gang from the slums of Bridgeton, a trip to the hills is an escape. It is also a reminder that other social workers, less well-known and less equipped to raise money, live with the problem of a bored and potentially violent youth every day. John Webster is a Church of Scotland minister, but there is little deference in the gang's attitude to him. He can promise them very little other than his friendship and the hope that he may persuade others to care.
What are you really trying to do with these lads? What's it all about?
It's a good question. What are they trying to do with me? You saw this just a minute ago, didn't you? To be friends, if you want, the easiest angle. To try and show that someone cares in an impersonal, violent world. This sounds perhaps high-fluting. It's, I think it's just a statement of fact. To show that someone cares. At school, fairly impersonal. Home life, fairly impersonal. Work, fairly impersonal. The street corner, the pub, the tote, the police. All impersonal. It has to be in many cases. Treat them as human beings. They'll respond.
Do you think that by doing this, though, you say they respond, do you in fact think that you can do anything to sort of lessen the violence of Glasgow?
I think so. I think if there was a lot of clubs like this, a big contribution could be made. We don't say we've the answer, but certainly the answer doesn't lie in pontificating from vacuums of inexperience. Letters to the papers. You know, get your MP, the councillors should do this, the police should do this. And the people who write these letters will not roll up their sleeves and get their hands in amongst it. If you know the boys as persons, then it seems there are redemptive possibilities.
What's a trip like this mean to them?
Well, I think you can see for yourselves. It's escape, you know? The police aren't here watching them. The local people aren't here. There's no one. They're just themselves. They can escape. They can be themselves. They can be rowdy. They won't be held for breach of the peace or anything like this. They're living here. Look, I mean, throwing stones around, cooking, putting a tent up, complete escape. They wouldn't like to live up here, mind you. They're much happier living cheek by jowl in their own community, with flooded back courts, with choked drains and this sort of thing. But here for a while they've escaped. The only way to do it is to get down amongst them. Bridgeton and other districts in Glasgow are leaderless communities because the professional people, they just bail out at night and the community reverts to type. There is no solution. We have no solution. But I think the nearest one can get to showing some kind of solution is to identify oneself, to care, to befriend, and you'll find that many of these boys, much maligned, are the salt of the earth.
Mr. Webster, you talk about this sort of professional exodus and the need, perhaps, for the letter writers and those who condemn to come in and help. But are there specific things that the government, that the Glasgow City Fathers can do?
I think do the same as your professional people might do. Provided there is a little money available, come in and befriend. People with cars can take six boys away for a weekend, skiing in the winter time, hill climbing in the summer, get to know just a small group. Let them see, I think, that the cars that flash through daily, you know, that the professional people in them care, that the bosses at the work care. The old days, it was an awful lot to be said for it when you had the community village built round the factory, when bosses and workers, in their spare time, played on the bowling green, played elsewhere together, were seen in the pubs together.
Do you think there's much likelihood of this happening in
Glasgow? Not a hope. And so you've no solution. The only solution is that somebody cares.
Stamford Street, that's more or less the main thoroughfare in Barrowfield, you know. And at the Gallagher end, you have what they term themselves as a torch. It's a gang, yeah. And at the bottom end, it's the spur, you call them. And on occasion, you get these two, which is only natural, as gangs have done through the years. You get them rattling one another. And you'll get them throwing missiles, cans, bottles, what have you, at one another, you know. Well, our house is more or less in no man's land, you know. We're sort of, you know, we were in between it, you know. Not just our house, but other houses, you know, other closes. I went out when they've been doing it, and they haven't bothered me. I mean, this is a personal vendetta between the bottom of the street and the top of the street. Unless either end know you are a member of either faction. Nine times out of ten, they don't bother with you, because I've went to the shop and I've been doing it. I've just kept close out the road and I went down and got bread, cigs, whatever, and came back up the road again.
Just dodged the bricks?
Yeah. I know it's ludicrous to say this, but sometimes it can be funny. You know, you stand and you watch them squealing and bawling at one another, you know. And it can be quite funny at times, as long as nothing untoward has really happened, you know.
Maybe
I'm
just anywhere.
Yeah. Right, this is the tap end, right? This is the top end, right? This is the mob at O'Reilly and all that, right? Don't hear that sort of mob, but they all run away and all that, and me go down.
They come up, no.
They're getting when they come up when we're all waiting. But see, like someone, we're all waiting. They're all scampering like wee rats going in holes.
A mile to the east of Glasgow city centre, behind the stands of Celtic football ground, is Barrowfield, the hardest place to live in a hard city. It's one of the roughest housing schemes in Britain. At first, the police insisted we had their protection to film here. Later, we moved more freely into the Barrowfield Triangle and didn't disappear without trace. But among the 600 or so families here is concentrated a sullen, futile mixture of crime and unemployment, single-parent poverty, and a daily fear of vandalism and violence. But among all the accepted social problems, the clichés of the inner city, there's a dimension of Barrowfield peculiar to Glasgow. Two or three times a week, families watch from their windows as the Torch and the Spur, successors to the razor gangs of the 60s, turn Stamford Street into what the Scottish papers have billed as Nightmare Alley.
Well, the reason this is called Nightmare Alley, because going back about 3-4 years ago, this mob down there called the Spur had come up, right? We were just hitting the hatches and all that. So it was that bad, rain for the Times and the Police, just put in the Monday morning in the Times and the Record, it was, in the Times it was called Mini Chicago, and in a Record it was called Nightmare Alley. So that is why us Torch Boys are called the Nightmare Alley.
You say you use hatchets?
That's a sword.
What kind of sword?
And you've been in a butcher's, getting upon a mince. Well, you walk out and you blag them. And that's
blag
that.
Them
put them down your, you go like that, put them down your juke, put it in, and that's that. You go away down and do the milky. Fuck's sake, man.
But you don't use fists?
That's on them. You don't go to the guys, man. It's a bruise. It just goes away. You go like that and that, man. That's it finished. Scars, man.
So when you're fighting, you're bound to get scars?
That's you under attack. That's you promoted.
are you proud of the scars you get?
No, you don't come proud of that. No, I don't. Well, we've not had much. It's, see, if you had to strip him, no, strip that mob down it.
See, scars are all the bodies.
That's like a map of Scotland.
What's wrong with this scheme?
It's not a scheme, it's the boys all fight. That's what it is. Oh, you shut up, that's just what she thinks about. Saturday night, that's the best, isn't it? Out your window.
Would you go out with a lad who fought in Stamford Street?
No. No, I wouldn't.
Why not?
Because if you went anywhere, they would end up with doing it, and you would end up winning, you know. Because you'd fight with everybody.
You would end up getting into the fight as well?
Aye, because if you were out with somebody and they get a doing, you would get into an arm, wouldn't you?
If they were done over, you would get done over too. So which part of the street are you from? Are you from Spurland or from Torchland?
Spur.
Is the Spur the best?
No, the best. You need to look down the phone. None of the best.
But most of the Torch and the Spur will end up in the hands of the law, probably on the road to prison. The front line of the intensive policing of Barrowfield is Kenny Ross, one-time shot put champion. He's now the scheme's community bobby.
I have asked them from the top end of the street, I've asked them from the bottom end of the street, and I'm still waiting for a suitable explanation why they fight with each other. They don't like to see each other get in the jail. But they can't give me a good reason why they want to fight with each other. They go to the same schools, and then at night they come out and start chasing each other. They'll puff out their puny chests. I think they're a big man.
Where are you hanging about here for?
You live here, but you don't. You get home with your own house. Beat it. Come. Go on.
Move.
Move.
If you show fear, you can chuck it. You've always got to have that appearance that you're capable of doing the job. You must never show fear. You can hang up your uniform if you show fear. They would just trample you into the ground.
I'd call this a pigeon loft. What do you call it?
A ducat.
Ducat?
Yeah.
How many birds can you keep in here, then?
Up to about 20.
So is that a locked inner door as well?
Yeah.
Good Lord. You teach Fort Knox a thing or two here. Can I come up?
Yes.
Well, having come to the top of the loft, we're now going back down into the bowels of it.
Yep.
And what's the difference between the two sorts of birds here, Andy?
The difference? Well, the ones up is there. They go out flying. These ones, they stay in here all the time, sit on top of eggs. No, so that we could breed them.
Have you any young ones here at the moment?
One of the youngest is this one. That's maybe 3 weeks. Just over 3 weeks. But that's about all. That is pretty young.
Yeah. Now, what's the object of the sport? I mean, do you race them, for example?
No. No, the object of it is to catch other people's birds. You know, they put them out, and we put one out. And it's more or less just a tackle. They go against each other.
So you let one pigeon off from here and you hope it nicks somebody else's pigeon and brings it back with it?
Exactly. That's it.
Do you notice that these pigeons have individual characters?
Well, they have. They definitely have, especially ones for flying. There's one up there. When you whistle on them, they're supposed to get up and fly. Well, they're supposed to, as I said. But this one, you've got to talk to it to get it up to fly. You know, it's just a wee quirk I've got, you know. Just running about here, you know what you call showing. That's blowing its chest up.
This is a real-life scene from the streets of downtown Glasgow, captured on closed-circuit television cameras. Roving bands of young guys make their way through the street. They move in on another youth. They corner him against a car. One of the guys pulls a knife, a machete in fact. It's a relentless, vicious attack. The boy nearly died. The teen wielding the knife was caught and charged with attempted murder. A random attack? No.
That's what the kids do on a Friday night. They will be sober when they leave home. They will take a knife with them. It will be a locking knife. They'll hide it down the front of their shorts. They'll go a short distance and they'll meet some of their friends. They'll share a bottle of wine. They'll share some high-strength lager or beer. Then they'll meet another group, and the other group will be the opposition, who will have had the same preparation for the evening. And then they'll fight.
Is that what they call a chip?
That's a slash.
When did that happen?
Well, when I was drunk, just got up fighting all that shit.
So I was in postal.
You're fleeing at my face.
Fucking mad.
What happened?
I was slashed by
a knife.
What's up? We don't have
And they could fight 100 times, and the worst that will happen is somebody will get caught and be kicked several times, or someone will get punched. But now and again, two men will square up, or young men will square up, one with a knife and the other with a baseball bat. Who dies and whose family visits the grave and whose family visits them in prison is completely random.
Knife crime is pervasive in Glasgow. Every 6 hours, someone reports a serious slash to the face. The scars are worn proudly, a measure of their manhood. These boys are from Postle Park, an area rife with gang activity.
It's the way of life.
What do you mean? Just close your face somewhere, people try to fight me in the town centre.
And it turns ugly,
right, sometimes.
Recreational violence, territorialism.
What's recreational violence?
There's no profit. If you're a robber and you present a knife to somebody and say, give me your watch, there's a profit in that. You're getting a watch for your trouble. With territorialism, recreational violence is just, why are you fighting? Because you don't come from here. We come from here, you come from there, we fight.
What causes the fight between gangs?
Rivalry.
Rivalry over what?
Because people want to be the best.
The best at what?
Best of fighting and madness. This bit I'm moving to Glasgow and I'll sue asses to the ground.
Here's the territory they come from and fight over. They're known as the schemes, the poorest parts of the city. In North America, we would call them the housing projects. The violence may start here, but as we showed you, it often spills onto the streets of downtown. Here's another example. On this particular night, several groups of young men meet up downtown, and the result is a full-on brawl. Over 600,000 people live in Glasgow. Some 2,000 boys and young men take part in gang violence.
There's nothing to make them think twice.
Kathleen Mulhall has lived in the Postle Park neighborhood her whole life. She knows some of the gang members here only too well.
My brother was attacked by a gang, and the injuries that they gave him caused him to die.
How old is he?
37.
Kathleen's brother Stephen was walking across a local park one night when he was attacked by a group of boys.
There was bricks and bottles and stones used, and there was also a metal scooter that was used to strike Stephen in the head.
A scooter?
A scooter. Oh, like a manual scooter.
The kind a child would use.
Yes, yeah. The impact that the scooter had in Stephen's head caused a fractured skull, which caused a blood clot, which over a period of time, because the blood clot was growing, caused Stephen to die.
After our interview, we were shooting scenes of graffiti on this wall near the park where Stephen was killed. Kathleen spots us and drives up.
Young Postal Fleeto, YPF.
She explains the significance of the names on the wall.
Billy Joe, he was charged with murder. He was 14 at the time, so that's his name there.
This, as it turns out, is what she has to look at every day. The names of neighborhood boys who have been charged with murder.
Darnem, as you can see, that's Darnem 02. He was charged with murder.
Including the name of the teenager who killed her brother.
You can make the assumption that what we've done up until now has not worked. And let's start again.
John Carnahan has been on the Strathclyde Police Force for over 30 years investigating these crimes every day. chasing and arresting young men. In fact, Carnahan has a permanent reminder of what it's like on the street.
What happened?
It was, I was a young detective and relatively fit, and there was a fella breaking into a school, and we get the call, went to it, saw him, chased him for about a mile and a bit. He was getting away and I was just about to give up. He jumped over a fence, and as I jumped over the fence, I caught my finger on the top. That was it. And the annoying thing is, for years after, I tried to find out who it was, because I wanted to go back to him years later and say, yeah, he cost me a finger.
The blade culture in Glasgow is nothing new.
Even a stabbing might not get more than a few lines down column in the Glasgow papers, because in this city of violence, ordinary stabbing is hardly news anymore.
For the last 30 years, the headlines have been practically the same as they are today. Today in Glasgow, gang violence takes as many lives as it did back in the 60s, about 70 people a year. Carnahan asked his chief intelligence officer to look into the situation, to give him a better idea of why this was happening.
I didn't just look at Glasgow in the last two or three years, I looked at it over 30 years. And what we found was that despite all the effort and money and time that we'd spent, we had made no appreciable impact into violence in Strathclyde.
Nothing.
McCluskey didn't only look at the crime statistics, she looked at every statistic coming out of the schemes. And suddenly, they had the big picture. This was not only the knife capital of Europe, these neighborhoods were a death trap for men in general.
For example, the average life expectancy for a man in the United Kingdom is 76. The average life expectancy for a man in Iraq after the war is 67. Here, in the poorest parts of Glasgow, the average life expectancy for a man is 54.
54. Why? It's a perfect storm of factors. High unemployment. One in six households is fully unemployed, no one is working. High rates of alcoholism, depression, lung disease, low levels of education. Now, armed with this information, Superintendent John Carnahan came to a new conclusion. The policeman decided that scenes like this weren't just a crime. He decided scenes like this were a public health catastrophe.
If you've got a block of flats with 15 flats in it, and they're on a street, and the street's in an area of high deprivation, why is it the kids who are in those flats, the guy in the top flat becomes a teacher, the woman on the other side, she ends up a prostitute and a heroin addict, and the boy at the bottom becomes a murderer, and the guy on the other side becomes a victim? Why is that? Why? They live in the same street, they live in the same area. The difference is what's behind the front door. The difference is those early years. So I think the way to look at it is perhaps different from that criminal justice thing. And the way to look at it perhaps is to, or understand, is to think about it in terms of a public health issue. If we had applied, for instance, let's say that 40 years ago public health had a problem with measles and they decided that what they wanted to do was use the criminal justice model. Well, how would they have applied it to that? They would have built more hospitals. When you got spots, they would have put you into the hospitals and isolated you. They would have got more nurses to look after you. And once the spots got better, they'd let you out again. Now, it wouldn't have affected measles. We wouldn't have cured measles. But everyone would have felt a bit safer because the people who had them and were infected were locked away.
Now, the detective isn't saying violent offenders shouldn't be locked away. In fact, there's a whole new raft of legislation.
Just what?
Fight with a lot.
I would question whether or not police should be doing this.
Some people think this social approach is not the responsibility of the police. For one, Bill Aiken, a former judge and now a Conservative member of Scottish Parliament.
Where I would part company is the fact that I think that basically this is not a matter for police. This is a matter for social work services, for the welfare services, looking after the unmarried mother. Someone's got to be doing that, of course they have. But basically police officers should be out investigating and deterring crime.
You should be policing, not teaching mums.
Yeah, absolutely. I don't want to teach mums. That's nothing to do with me. But I want people who should be doing it, doing it.
But critics of the new approach believe one thing. Tougher sentences and more jail time will make kids think twice before they pull that knife. That's the criticism now, that they aren't getting that message through lenient sentencing, yes. Mostly. People say that the sentences are too lenient for the kids to get any sort of message that the consequences are severe in this society.
Yeah. Well, there's always the argument about, it's back to the, you know, let's build more jails and lock more people up.
Right.
It's like the measles argument. It'll make us all feel much better, but it won't make one iota of difference to what's there.
Really?
They don't think about it. When they get into that fight, it's the heat of battle. It's that guy fighting you. You don't want him to get you. You want to get him. End of story. The last thing in anybody's mind is, I can end up in prison for this. Nobody thinks about that. Nobody.
What do you guys keep fighting if it's so dangerous?
Pride.
Carnahan and his team have only started their research into gang violence a year and a half ago. So it's early days. In contrast, young men have been fighting each other in Glasgow for generations. Everyone knows this problem won't be solved tomorrow, including Carnahan himself.
There isn't a single solution to this. I think it'll be 1,000 victories.
How long are we talking?
I think it'll take a couple of generations. But that shouldn't deter us, because we can start to make differences very quickly, I think. What we need to do is we need to be brave enough to commit to that long term. We need to say, yeah, enough is enough.
Do you think everybody's ready to do that, say enough is enough?
I think there are more and more people coming around to it, but I don't think everyone is there yet. Because the most important people that need to say that are the people who live in these challenged communities, are the young men who are in gangs. We need to help them to walk away from them and say, I don't want to involve in this anymore.
As for Kathleen Mulhall, she won't stick around to find out how this story ends. She's had enough, all right. She's moved out of her apartment to another, safer part of town.
It's time to leave here. There's too many bad memories here. I don't feel that I want to be part of a community that they're all part of.
As for the boys of Postle Park, are they ready to say enough, to say no to gang violence? There's clearly a long way to go yet.
Sarah Jelinek and Kirsty Bowden from Australia.
This is my Friday night entertainment here, look.
The only British victim was James McMullen.
What's he doing? He's going to help him or not? Come on.
His mother, Milagros, and sister, Melissa.
Fuck you.
All their attempts to remember James have been disregarded.
Yeah, fucking shit, Maggie. Oh, right in time, look. Oh!
He's got a big machete, hasn't he?
Is that a machete? He's
moving the woods. He's got his fuck. Well, he's knocked her ear, you know him,
dude. Oh, he's fucked, aye.
Put something in his mouth.
Look, she's got a...
I'm in Glasgow and it's Friday evening. Glasgow has one of the biggest problems with knife culture and gang violence in Europe. Glasgow's done a lot in recent years to improve its image, but the problems are still there in housing schemes like Pollock, where I grew up. I was a youth worker there and I got to see for myself what can happen to an area when it's left to rot over a generation. I've now moved out of Pollock and I live in a more affluent part of town. I'm just as skint as I was before, but I feel a lot safer. My heart's still in Pollock, but it doesn't mean that I particularly like to go back there. I'm standing on the Green Bridge in the area where I grew up. Now this bridge has traditionally been a place where gangs would meet to fight. We're going to see if we can track down some gangs tonight. So what do you fight for?
To what be else we going to do? Right in possession. To make sure that them no shite bags.
Not for a joint.
So that's the way it's going to be, man. Or the way it's going to be as a crunch life. Because you've been through my dad, you know, that's life.
Right,
so it just follows on from then.
We have a
particularly in Glasgow and the west of Scotland, lots of youth gangs, groups of young people gathered around a territory. And the territory might just be two or three streets, and there is recreational violence.
So it's a pride thing then? Aye. It's a bit of pride thing basically. You just don't want to let it decide in.
The violence with young men can be quite intense.
So do you never worry about the actual how serious it sometimes can get?
All we basically worry about is who will be stabbing this weekend.
And that's where lots and lots of our serious injuries and murders occur.
So what do you do before you go and fight? But get mad, wait, oh fucking. Basically, it's all down to drink at the end of the day because you've got the adrenaline in you, man, they can stop you. I think it's difficult to avoid violence in an area like Pollock. I think how you get involved in it, you have a choice. You can choose to stay out of the gang thing, or you can choose to be part of it. I suppose I just resigned myself to the fact when I was younger that there was a chance if I walked too far away from my own house, then I could get into a scuffle, because most of the time it's people preying on what they perceive to be an easy target. That's how this sort of works.
I think the media use the young people as a scapegoat for basically a lot of social problems in society. We did take a chance in bringing them together. Mrs. Wright, we're taking you outside the area, and it worked.
Before I joined the project, I felt unsafe, to be honest, unsafe to walk over all the fill of pot. But now that I've joined the project, I've now stopped from fighting, I feel more safe than ever. But like, I still feel a teeny bit unsafe, but by the end of the day in pot, you will always look behind your shoulders.
Aye, that's enough.
How do you feel when you see, even in your own city, how different it can be in one area from another area?
I feel like a tramp, to be honest.
You feel lower class?
Aye, a lot lower class. Bet a lot.
Just get the young team and these two schemes together, see what can happen. But it won't happen.
Why not?
Because they hate each other, really. They hate each other.
I'm going to check out some of these websites. I know the young people are using them a lot to arrange things with one another, whether it be fighting or just meeting up or stuff like that. So I'm going to check out some of these sites just to see what I'm letting myself in for. The majority of them I don't think carry. That's my gut feeling. I think there'll be a few that do and that do carry, and that's fair play to them. I can kind of understand why, so I'll just be a bit anxious about that, because it only takes 1 second of stupidity and then that's it, you know. So we'll just have to go and see how it goes. There's people covering the news in Baghdad, but then again the life expectancy in Baghdad's actually higher than it is in 8 places in Glasgow, so I don't know if that's really saying anything. We know that they hang around this area pretty much. Growing up here myself in the area, I'm familiar with the gang, and I'm also being honest saying that it's a place that I never usually would travel due to my preconceived ideas, and also that it's out of the three territories the furthest away from where I grew up. So I'm kind of anxious about that, and also the fact that we're going to meet a group of quite likely rowdy young people. So I've got my Dutch courage in hand here. It's probably not the most professional thing to do, but I did grow up here, so I know the deal. Okay, that's me feeling slightly better, as pathetic as it is, so let's do this. Where are you from then?
Pollock, right? What side of Pollock?
Young team.
I spoke to a few other boys from the other areas.
Gimps.
And gimps. What's a gimp for anybody who doesn't know?
Gimps.
So do you fight with
cross and bushy, crookie?
So when does that happen?
Every night. Not at Disney for.
At the weekends.
No point.
Okay. Word quickly got around that we were filming and a lot more guys turned up. At this point, I began to feel a bit anxious. One of them then tried to grab the camera.
All right, guys. No.
My instincts told me it was time to leave.
You got that, bitch?
Get my face out, man.
I don't know if I was being paranoid or perhaps I'd been spending too much time reading the newspapers. But when you're in a situation like that, you just have to go with your gut feeling.
This character. Well, it's fucking Liam Parker, right?
What's obvious is that there's no quick fix solution. To be fair to the police, they realise this too and are working to link up with the likes of education and social work services. Groups like the YMCA can help to make a real difference at local level, although their budgets are tight to say the least. This is a historical problem that may take more than a generation to solve, and unfortunately for me, I don't have a generation to wait. I just think it's a sad day that I had to leave the area that I grew up in because I never felt safe.
So there's nothing today, look. Could you find that today here? Look a bit.
Glasgow has a problem with gangs, and on this estate, they've been at war for decades. I've come to Easter House to find the teenagers fighting for their streets. This is Revealed Extra.
Are you ready?
I'm ready.
I think the Commonwealth Games is one of the best things to happen to this community.
You're fucking bad.
Coming up from a decrepit shithole to a nice area.
Once thriving, Kilmarnock used to have over 10,000.
They in the east end of Glasgow, and it's notorious for its gangs. There's the Dentoy, the Baltoy, the Drummy, the Proggy and the Agro. Gang names, most of which have existed since the estate was built in the 1950s. The teenagers fighting today say they're in the same gangs as their dads and granddads were, and that fights like these, caught on CCTV, aren't that unusual. At times, murder's been the most common cause of death here for young men. I've been told that in the first 5 months of last year, there were 12 stabbings. The latest person was killed just weeks ago. So, I'm off to try and find the gangs. I don't know whether anyone will want to tell me what goes on here. When someone does agree, he seems nervous to talk on film, so we're keeping his identity secret.
Tell me what gang you're in.
Drummy.
What goes on in the Drummy?
Fighting. Bah.
What kind of fighting?
Gang fighting, obviously.
Have you been involved in it?
Never been in a gang fight in my life. But obviously, I'm not going to tell you that exists in front of a camera, you know what I mean?
Okay.
You end up getting caught with grass and all that.
He is drunk, and I can't tell whether he's exaggerating for the camera. But seeing he isn't happy saying much makes me wonder just what kind of trouble he'd be in if he did. Back in the car, I spot a group in an area I've been told is controlled by another gang.
What gang are you in?
Provi.
The Provi.
The Provi Rebels.
Walk down to the shopping centre and you see somebody, you'll end up fighting. What's the
one word which comes up quite a lot is this word scheme, and that is basically a part of an estate. What do you mean by scheme?
Different areas.
Housing scheme.
If you walk through Drummy, you'd be fighting.
I get my fingers chopped off.
You get your fingers chopped off?
Aye.
Really? You get your fingers chopped off?
Aye.
You know your people who've had their fingers chopped off?
Aye.
It's got to mess you up, hasn't it, growing up?
It's just what happens, a way of life.
Happens, doesn't it?
A way of life.
Aye.
It's almost like people here are conditioned to violence or to seeing violence. And when you're told that there's a lad being taken down the field and his fingers have been chopped off with a machete, but he deserved it, that blows your mind, really. What way is it a way of life?
It's a reputation.
No, it's just a thing. Father.
If you weren't in the Provi, would people not respect you?
No, I never really respect you.
Do people get killed here?
Yeah.
Do people get killed in these fights?
A couple get murdered there on a weekend.
Was that gang related? What are you fighting for?
This team, in ourselves.
Your area?
Huh?
You're fighting for this?
So that's territory, that's
protecting yourself.
Would you die for this then?
I'd die for Provi.
You'd die for Provi?
Yep.
I wonder if he would go that far, or if it's all just banter for camera. The police say things have improved here and that they know who the troublemakers are.
One officer told us the last big gang fight was last summer. The next day, and I still haven't really got my head round what the gangs are fighting for. I meet Sean. He used to be in the drummy and says he still knows the gang, but that he doesn't fight anymore.
Whose area is this?
This is the drummies.
What about those houses over there?
That's Dentoy. The boundary's lit at the top of that hill. And that's the Dentoy.
So if you were to go over that hill, what happens?
If people were to see you, then probably get involved in a fight. The drummy and the older ones, like, expect the younger ones to live up to the name.
From what we've been told, you've got a couple of lads coming over this side, you've got two lads there, the rest of them hiding in the bushes. By the time they get to the middle, the rest of them come at them with whatever weapons they've got. They'll throw bottles, bricks. You're not fighting a war.
No, it's like, well, people are like, right, I'll say like, the troops and all that, it's not really like an army or anything.
A lot of people are trying to distance themselves initially from being involved in a gang. So while they're not necessarily saying they're in the gang anymore, if someone comes into their area and there's a fight, I get the sense they'd still be involved. Do you reckon you could end up fighting again with the drumming?
I reckon it could happen because like, you never know, but if I got an option, then I'd prefer to say no.
You hear about gangs around the world, and when you hear about it, it's often associated with drugs. I'm told that isn't the case here. What is it all about, then?
It's just about reputation of the territory, but not related to any money or drugs.
And is there a leader?
No.
Such a gang?
Basically, everybody's just doing it on themselves.
So people are putting their lives at risk for nothing more than a street?
Yep.
When you say it like that, it sounds a bit stupid, doesn't it?
It does, but it's been happening for that long now and basically it won't stop.
Thursday evening in the Baltoy gang area and something's kicking off, but it isn't a gang fight. The police have stopped a cart that had earlier been taken from another part of town. After a few days, I'm starting to get the picture. The gangs fight to protect their patch, their scheme, from, well, nothing more than other lads walking into them. So far, I've had no problem walking into any area until I approach this group.
You gonna do me, mate?
Their instant reaction is that I'm looking for a fight.
We'll be able to have a chat with you. Okay. Okay.
What I don't realise is that while I'm explaining what I'm doing to these lads, others are threatening the crew. After things calm down, one of the lads, Jordan, says he wants to talk.
Like, that's his skinheads, mate, right?
The skinheads.
You're right. Obviously, man, I'm grown out, you know what I mean? But it's part of your culture. You grow up in the atmosphere. I'll tell you, mate, I was.
What sort of things have you seen?
Stuff that I wouldn't like to describe. You can take me to Easter House, but you can't take the Easter House out of me.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? At the end of the day, right, I've grown up here, right, for every scheme in Easter House, you know what I mean? But see, at the end of the day, man, backfires on you.
How do you get out of it?
Well, see, honestly, you can really get out of it.
I now realise that what I did, a stranger approaching a group, could be enough to start a fight here.
Yeah, you've got a lot of boys, mate, Camilla, and approach this guy, mate.
I get the impression that Jordan's frustrated that it's difficult to get away from gang culture in Easter House once you've been a part of it. Others are telling me that they don't want to lose their mates' respect by not being involved, and that a big part of the problem is they've got nothing to do apart from get drunk. I meet up again with Sean, and this time he's with his mate Darren, who also used to be in a gang. I want to find out what goes on in Easter House during the day.
Not much at all.
Nothing, really?
Nothing, exactly.
Drinking starts pretty early on a Friday.
Yes.
Do you think the idea of fighting for an area has gotten and actually now all you're doing is fighting because people are drunk?
I think it is just because you're drunk.
And just try to live up to the name of the scheme.
Aye.
Do you want to just get out of here then as soon as you can? Is that the plan?
No, I wouldn't like to get out. I would just like to get a secure job. I've been paid off and on so many times. That's why I prefer going to something to do with sports.
Sean and Darren used to be in rival gangs and say they're only friends now because of football. Now, this might look like any pitch, but it's one of the only places in Easter House where the gangs will come together, not to fight, but to play football. The coach says these lads are from all the different gang areas and that they've crossed territories to be here. It might sound weird, but they're all on the same team, the Phoenix.
Do you think people kind of say that they're not involved in it, but actually there will be people who are involved in it?
People say that they're not involved in it, but they are. Don't like to be known to be doing it, but they're doing it.
Would you say you were one of those people?
I was, but no anymore.
What made you stop?
Football.
Football?
Yeah, what is it? I go to other places and see my pals.
Do you reckon there's a risk that if you are involved in this fighting, you could get stabbed and you could die?
No. High risk.
A high risk? Is that just something that you've accepted?
Aye.
I've seen it in Easter, I've seen it in acceptance.
Do you all know people who've been stabbed?
Aye. I've seen somebody getting stabbed, but like instead of leaving them, they just kept stabbing them.
They agree football's the one thing that's helping them get out of the gangs, and that it's alcohol that's fueling the violence among those still involved. I've heard there's drinking by the lake on a Friday evening, so I've come to have a look.
Are you part of a gang? What gang are you in? The Provi.
Fight with your family, we drink, and then we go and chasing for a laugh.
You go and chasing for a laugh?
Aye.
Do any of the girls ever kind of like get involved as well?
No. It's only the boys because they're not happy.
No, we get involved in one fight, didn't we? Get it in, man! Look at my
Tell us then what happens on a Friday night.
Everybody gets drunk. Yeah.
I've got a scar right there. I get stabbed there. I was fighting. I get stabbed there.
What were you stabbed with?
A bottle, I think. I was a wee guy. I thought it was a gangster. And I was...
Someone stabbed you with a bottle.
Aye.
This bottle here contain a really strong wine, and it's also mixed with caffeine. While they're on this and you're talking to them, 99% of the time it's quite jovial, it's quite friendly. You just get that sense that something could snap. It's that kind of on-edge feeling that can make you understand how very quickly something which seems just like a rowdy bunch turns into something a bit more violent.
The police arrive to move the group on, but some aren't ready to go home. Lads from the Provi come to talk, then a rival gang drive past.
I've broken there, you this ain't your bam!
So they're a different gang?
Aye.
Would you fight with them?
Aye.
You would?
Obviously.
The boys are on the edge of their patch. This territorialism, without making money, makes them very different from other gangs around the world.
We're taking a little bit of a drive around Easter House later on at night to try and get a sense of what things are like around here. And one thing we've started to get a sense of after spending a few days here is that people are aware of who we are. We're getting quite a lot of looks as we drive around. We're certainly getting to be quite well known around Easter House.
We're starting to have problems going into areas with the camera, so we agree I should approach the next group without the crew, but things don't go well.
They were all saying, we're the aggro. I said, is it all right for me to bring the camera around? Yeah, fine. And then one guy literally was like, you can't do that. You can't bring a camera in here. People will know. People will think we're grasses. And as we were leaving, there was one guy with his key sticking out of his fist. Just felt like he wanted a fight.
Is that the first time?
No, we're going. We're going. Get the wire. In fact, they're right there right now, so we're going. There were at least three guys who were then literally running full pelt at us, shouting. It's kind of that territorialism which you can understand why some of the other lads around here don't want to be seen going over towards the aggro. But their attitude and the way that they are so uninviting to you to go into a certain area, as if you are actually on their area, makes you feel a little bit like anything could happen. Yeah, I'm pretty glad we're not there anymore, to be honest. One of those things that Easter House has got a name for. When you ask someone if they've seen anyone being stabbed, they'll go, yeah, that's taken a while to get used to. And I think all of them will say to you, it is a way of life. This is the way things are around here. All of them say it's really difficult to get away from being in a gang because they don't want their mates not to like them and respect them. And it is all about respect.
There's no doubt people...
He's not happy, boy. Here we go. No, pussy yours. Oh, here we go. And there we go.
My boy's getting a monster.
Get him.
look up, 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 look up,